U.S. Joint Forces Command Headquarters, Pentagon, August 15, 2002. In a simulated war game between a red team led by retired Marine Corps Lieutenant General Paul Van Riper, having artillery and combat boats similar to what Iran may have had at the time, faced off against a vastly better equipped and more technologically advanced blue team led by Army General Burwell B. Bell, representing the U.S. fleet in the waters around the Persian Gulf. The red team used unconventional methods, launching massive simultaneous attack of cruise missiles at the U.S. Navy. So many did they fire at the same time that the blue team's Aegis ballistic missile defense system couldn't cope with the number and were repeatedly hit. Then in guerrilla style, they used small, powerful speedboats staging suicide attacks to finish off what was left of the blue team. Detailed in Mika Zenko's 2015 book, Red Team, How to Succeed by Thinking Like the Enemy, Blue Team Commander Bell admitted,
"Riper's forces sunk my damn navy in an attack from which we learnt a great lesson."
This great lesson may come in handy as tensions flare once again in the region. Saboteurs, possibly state-sponsored, attacked oil tankers passing through the Gulf of Oman. Images revealed them attaching magnetic limpet mines to cause damage. Iranians denied any role in the attack as their search and rescue team helped pick up 44 sailors from the two damaged tankers. If their intention was to disrupt oil prices, they were unsuccessful. Crude prices went up marginally and only for a short while, fluctuating within a narrow band. See Bisbo's video on why global crude prices will continue to remain stable. According to satellite photos of Iran's ports released by the US, small traditional sailing boats known as dhows were shown being fitted with cruise missiles, which were dismissed as out of hand by Iran's ambassador to the United Nations, using Trump's favorite words.
"Fake intelligence. It is a deliberate attempt to set up an excuse to wage war."
Meanwhile, the US upped the ante by sending a squadron of B-52 bombers, an extra Patriot air defense system, 1,500 additional troops, and stationed aircraft carrier USS Abraham Lincoln with F-22 fighter jets just outside the Persian Gulf. A week later, spotting a US military MQ-4C Triton surveillance drone hovering 8 miles off its coast over the southern Iranian province of Hormozgan, Iran fired their locally built Khordad missile to shoot it down. GPS coordinates released by the Iranians put it at 8.3 nautical miles or about 15 kilometers of their coast, within the 12 nautical miles or 22 kilometers of its claimed territorial waters, though US say their drone was further away at 18.5 nautical miles. Despite it marking the first time the Islamic Republic directly attacked the American military, the incident was surprisingly downplayed by Trump.
"A loser, stupid general or somebody made a very big mistake."
The head of Iran's Revolutionary Guards Aerospace Division claimed that a P-8 Poseidon military aircraft accompanied the drone.
"But we opted not to attack it because there were 35 people on board."
The day after the drone's downing, so as not to look weak in an apparent bluff,
"Go ahead with the attack on the three sites."
Giving notice to the Iranians of his intended actions, Trump gave them a short window to respond to his offer of talks, to which they received an aggressive response.
"Any attack on Iran will have regional and international consequences."
Trailers of such incidents were already given when in May 19, Iranian-backed Shia Houthi tribesmen in Yemen attacked the east-west Saudi pipeline using drones, while Baghdad's safe green zone saw some Iranian Katyusha rocket attacks, possibly fired by militia loyal to their Shiite neighbors. Then with 10 minutes to go, in typical dramatic style, Trump called off the probably non-existent strike.
"General, how many casualties do you expect on the Iranian side?"
"Probably 150, sir."
"Stop it. That's too many people to die for an attack on an unmanned drone."
Earlier, US presidents too had backed down from strikes at the last minute. Obama in 2013 withdrew the planned attack on Syria's leader Bashar Assad, while Bill Clinton in 1998 aborted a missile strike on Iraq at the last minute. Iran looked to Europe for help in allowing them to sell oil and permit them access to financial markets. But no European country wished to risk US retaliation. Instead, in tacit support of the US, UK's Royal Marines boarded and seized an Iranian oil tanker off the coast of Gibraltar for breaking EU's oil embargo on Syria. As Trump's term enters its final leg, he desperately searches for a foreign policy victory by doubling his effort to push Iran to the negotiating table. US Secretary of State Mike Pompeo has made 12 demands outside of the nuclear deal, and all are linked to Iran abandoning its expansionist policies of supporting militant groups, Houthis in Yemen, Hezbollah in Lebanon, Shiite groups in Iraq. Iran sees this and is attempting to create bargaining chips in a future negotiation by threatening and carrying out their threat. We now possess over the 300-kilometer limit of uranium imposed on us by the nuclear deal. Then warning that they would enrich uranium above the 3.67% purity level, reportedly to between 5 and 20%, claiming it would be used to create medical isotopes for cancer treatment. Weapons-grade uranium requires 90% enrichment, and by breaching either the stockpile or purity limit, it does not radically alter the timeline of 1 year. It will still take them to make a nuclear bomb. While both sides publicly claim not to want war, the US made fresh plans after the request of John Bolton, Trump's national security advisor.
"We have here offensive and retaliatory military options."
Bolton has made no secret of his desire for regime change, as penned in an op-ed piece in the Wall Street Journal.
"America's declared policy should be the ending of Iran's 1979 Islamic Revolution."
The best way to bring down the regime or force Iran into a new deal is through the Trump administration's avowed target of
"We're going to zero."
Before the US unilaterally pulled out of the Iran nuclear deal, see Bisbo's detailed video on it, Iran exported 2 million barrels of oil per day. Now it is half, and Pompeo's target is zero. And while India was forced to stop importing Iranian oil, it has managed to ring-fence Chabahar port, though banking curbs have made it impossible to get any work done there. See Bisbo's video on the importance of Chabahar port to India's strategic interests. Meanwhile, the US continues their attempt to sabotage Iran's strike capability through cyber attacks on its missile launch system. Trump, playing good cop this time, on the face of it, offered a generous compromise.
"We are ready to talk to Iran without preconditions. I can cut a deal even with the mullahs."
But age-old Iranian traditions of face fly against the just-do-it culture of America.
"We too are ready, as long as Washington treats Tehran with respect."
Trump is alternatively courting North Korea and Iran to give up nuclear weapons, hoping convincing one of them will be his ticket for re-election as president in 2020. Both countries are using diametrically opposite strategies to counter him, with differing outcomes. North Korea's leader sweet talks Trump, has met him thrice and got concessions without giving up anything, while Iran stubbornly plays hardball, refuses to meet him and gets additional sanctions imposed instead. In April 1988, in the largest naval engagement since World War II, the US Navy attacked Iranian naval forces in retaliation for mining the Persian Gulf. In a matter of hours, half of Iran's navy was sunk or destroyed. Will Trump eventually order a strike, or will he continue bluffing? Bisbo's Limerick. Iran's up the ante in the Persian Gulf. Sanctions are driving them to do crazy stuff. Shooting down a drone made Trump groan as he ordered an airstrike in an apparent bluff. Subscribe to Bisbo's channel and be sure to click on the bell icon. Be the first to know when Bisbo releases a new video.